The musical Oklahoma by Rodgers and Hammerstein came out in the 1940s. It's generally known as the first real musical. But is it? Were there musicals that came before Oklahoma that set the standards that made Oklahoma such a big success? We're also going to be delving into the history of musical theater. Where did musical theater start? And how did it develop into the popular form of entertainment that it is today? Let's delve into this and find out tonight on Investigating Theater. Oklahoma is known as the first musical because it had a book that told a story. A book for a musical is like a play's script. So the book, the lyrics, and the music all combine together to tell a story. Oklahoma came out at a time when there were variety shows, cabaret acts, and a lot of scantily clad girls in lines kick dancing. Oklahoma's also a special show because when it first came out and Aunt Eller is churning butter, nobody'd ever seen anything like that before. Usually when the curtains would go up on a theatrical production, it would be a line of scantily clad girls in glitz and glamour with lots of makeup and feathers in their hair. And they'd all be, you know, doing the kick line. So in this play, when the curtain goes up, there's a woman churning butter. So that was very different than what people were used to seeing back then in the 1940s. So Oklahoma opened on Broadway on March 31st, 1943. It was based on a play by Lynn Riggs, a 1931 play called Green Grow the Lilacs. It was set in Claremore, Indiana Territory in 1906 and tells pretty much exactly the same story. The show ran for an unprecedented 2,212 performances, but it actually didn't win a Tony Award because there were no Tony Awards for musicals back then. Rodgers and Hammerstein actually won a special Pulitzer Prize for Oklahoma in 1944. The musical built on the innovations of the earlier show Showboat, which epitomizes the development of the book musical, a play where the songs and dances are fully integrated into a well-made story with serious dramatic goals that are able to evoke genuine emotion other than laughter. Because, as I said, the shows that went up before Oklahoma and Showboat were cabaret, with no serious dramatic goals and no story. In the early 1940s, Rodgers and Hammerstein were already well known for creating a whole bunch of Broadway hits, but they never created anything quite like Oklahoma. And this show's casting was very different from most other Rodgers and Hammerstein shows and most shows of the time, in that in between both the World Wars, World War I and World War II, roles in musical theater were usually given to singers, people who could sing rather than act. Singing was more important than acting, but Rodgers and Hammerstein chose conversely to cast singers who could act, which is huge. That goes along with the idea of having a book musical that tells a story. The show had no musical theater stars. All the actors in the show were pretty much unknown at the time. The show closed on May 29th, 1948. The demand for tickets was completely unprecedented, and the show became popular in the months that followed. And the show ran for 5 years, which is a Broadway record that wouldn't be bested until My Fair Lady, all the way up in 1956. This is according to a playwright and theater writer named Thomas Hishak. He says, quote, "Not only is Oklahoma the most important of the Rodgers and Hammerstein musicals, It is also the single most influential work in the American musical theater. It was the first, as I've said, fully integrated musical play, and its blending of song, character, plot, and even dance would serve as a model for Broadway shows for decades. Another theater person, his name's William Zeinzer, said that Oklahoma broke old musical comedy conventions with songs delving into character and advancing the plot. The show would, quote, become a milestone so that later historians writing about important moments in 20th century theater would begin to identify eras according to their relationship with Oklahoma. And the things that Rodgers and Hammerstein did with Oklahoma were built upon, and shows that we see nowadays, like Year in Town and Spring Awakening, so on and so forth, and the popular shows that are on Broadway nowadays, are all thanks to Rodgers and Hammerstein. Now we're going to go into the actual historical background of plays and musicals, how they got started, and how a musical became to be defined as it is today. So let's get into that. The theater got its start in the 5th century BCE in Greece. Playwrights like Euripides, Aeschylus, and Aristophanes wrote some of the greatest plays of all time, and their play structure can be seen today in our modern theater, some 2,500 years later. In the 12th and 13th centuries, religious dramas were very popular. During the European Renaissance, commedia dell'arte and opera buffa were very popular. During the Tudor period, there were things called court masks. The first recognizable English opera is called The Siege of Rhodes, which came out in 1656. During the 17th century, Molière, a playwright, and Jean-Baptiste Lully were both popular in France. Henry Purcell and John Blow were two famous composers for English opera. During the 18th century, the ballad opera, called The Beggar's Opera, was the longest-running play of any kind, with 62 consecutive performances in 1728. In 19th century England, music halls, melodramas, and burlesque were popular. In Italy and Europe, something called spingsiel, comedy and vaudeville, opera comique, and zarzuela were popular.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will conclude this part of the entertainment with a brand new song sung here in Chicago for the first time on any stage by myself and company.
America actually didn't have a significant theater presence until 1752, when William Hallam started the Old American Company, which was the first fully professional theater company to perform in North America. In 1850, theater moved to Midtown Manhattan. Theater officially moved to Times Square around the 1920s and 30s.
And a big black horse. Do-da, do-da. They fly the track and they both cut across.
In France in the 1950s, there was operetta.
Touch bottom with a 10-foot pole. In
1860, the musical Seven Sisters came out. Offenbach and Strauss were popular in the 1870s and 80s. Their pieces formed a model for musical theater that followed. Musical burlesques, music hall, pantomime, and burlette dominated the London music stage into the 1870s. During the mid-19th century, variety revue was popular. Vaudeville and minstrel shows eventually went to Britain. The first recognizable original comedy is The Black Crook, which came out in 1866. This was an original musical that conformed into many of the modern definitions of a musical, including dance and original music that helped tell the story. It had lots of girls in skimpy costumes and ran for an unprecedented 474 performances. In 1866, musicals The Black Domino and Between You, Me, and the Post came out. You, Me, and the Post was sold as a, quote, musical comedy. Edward Harrigan and Tony Hart started their own company. They were performers and comedians in 1876 to 1885. Because of the improvement of transportation and street lighting, patrons started to come out at night to see theater. Plays became longer, which provided a greater profit for those who put them on, and people began bringing their families to see plays. Chimes of Normandy from 1878 ran for 500 consecutive performances, the longest of the time. Gilbert and Sullivan came out with The Mikado and HMS Pinafore in 1885 and 1878, respectively. These shows were successful on both sides of the ocean and helped to up the bar for what was seen as a good musical. Also, these shows were designed for families, rather than men who wanted to get a hard-on watching ladies dance around in skimpy outfits. Gilbert and Sullivan's influence on later musical theater conventions was profound. How to, quote, fully integrate lyrics and dialogue to advance a coherent story, rather than having big musical dance numbers that interrupted the plot entirely, which had been the convention before. In 1891, A Trip to Chinatown ran for 675 performances, the most so far. In 1896, A Trip to Coontown came out. It was the first musical produced and performed entirely by African Americans on Broadway. During the 1890s and the early 20th century, George M. Cohan created a distinctly American style of musical theater. During the gay 90s, George Edwards experimented with modern dress, family-friendly styles, breezy popular songs, snappy romantic banter, and a stylish spectacle. He formed the respectable core of Gaiety Girls. Two of his most well-known shows were In Town and A Gaiety Girl. A Gaiety Girl is about a poor maiden who loves an aristocrat and wins him against all odds. This was a typical plot at the time. In 1890, The Geisha came out, which ran for 2 years, which was unprecedented at the time. In 1898, The Belle of New York was the first American musical to run for over a year in London. In 1901, A Chinese Honeymoon ran for a record-setting 1,074 performances. At the beginning of the 20th century, Charles Forham and Seymour Hicks did The Arcadians and The Quaker Girl in 1909 and 1910, respectively. Again, during the early 20th century, The Merry Widow came out. In 1907, to be more specific, it was an operetta. Also, during that same year, Victor Herbert produced several successful operettas, including the famous Babes in Toyland. During the 1910s, something called the Princess Theater Shows started. During World War I, the musical Irene ran for 670 performances, a record that would stand until 1938. In the British theater scene, The Maid of the Mountains ran for 1,352 performances, and the musical Chu Chin Chow ran for a record of 2,238 performances. This record stood for almost 40 years. The Roaring Twenties borrowed from vaudeville, music hall, and other light entertainments and showcased big dance numbers and popular songs with no plot. Famous composers such as Gershwin, Berlin, Porter, and Rodgers and Hart were famous during this time. These spectacular shows were expensive, with extravagant sets, elaborate costumes, and beautiful chorus girls. A famous musical of this time is the 1921 musical Shuffle Along, that was an all-African-American Broadway hit. From the 19th century through to the 1920s, America took over as innovators for popular musical entertainment. Ragtime and jazz musical styles started to be integrated into theater shows during this time. Famous Tin Pan Alley composers whose work was heard on Broadway included. There were a lot of famous Tin Pan Alley composers whose work was heard on Broadway. During this time, the Schubert brothers took control of Broadway theaters. Showboat came out in 1927. It was way ahead of its time. Quote, here comes a completely new genre. The musical play was distinguished from musical comedy. Now everything else was subservient to this play. Now came complete integration of song, humor, and production numbers into a single and inextricable artistic entity. During the Great Depression, audiences went back to wanting lighthearted entertainment, and few stage shows ran more than 500 performances during this decade. They used to tell me Fred Astaire starred in The Bandwagon in 1930. Ethel Merman cemented herself as the first lady of musical theater in 1934's Anything Goes. The 1938 musical Hell's a Poppin' was the longest musical of this decade. The 1931 musical Of the I Sing won the very first Pulitzer Prize. The 1933 musical, As Thousands Cheer, was the first musical to have black and white actors share the stage. Other important musicals that came out during this decade are Porgy and Bess, that came out in 1935, and The Cradle Will Rock by Orson Welles, which came out on Broadway in 1937. In the 1920s and 30s, Broadway started to have to compete with film. In the 1920s, The Jazz Singer, the first picture with sound, came out, and during the 1930s, The Talkie came out, meaning pictures with sound. Just before Oklahoma came out, despite the woes of the 1930s and the competition from film, musical theater endured. In fact, it continued to evolve thematically beyond the gags and showgirls of the gay 90s and the roaring 20s, and the sentimental romance of opera, adding technical expertise and the fast-paced staging and naturalistic dialogue led by director George Abbott. This leads us to the 1940s when Oklahoma came out. So, as you can see, Oklahoma was the first musical that really made some huge steps forward in terms of book, lyrics, and music combining together to tell a real emotional story that would evoke emotions in the audience, rather than them just laughing or being titillated by dancing women in skimpy outfits. Oklahoma really made some huge strides in musical theater, and it did set the precedent for the musical as we know today. And it's why we have musicals like Phantom and Spring Awakening and Year in Town. Rodgers and Hammerstein were really geniuses, but as you can see, they had help. So thank you for watching this episode. I'm not quite sure what I'm going to do next, but I hope you enjoy. Please be sure to like, share, and subscribe, and I'll see you next time. Thanks for watching. Never do pass life as in June. And you hear you boo-boo. You know I'm waiting for you. We've got some loving to do under the moon. That's all.